Preparing to delve in 3, 2, 1.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to Delve. My name is Nathan.
And I'm Alex.
And, Alex, happy birthday.
Oh, thank you, Nathan. Yeah, this episode comes out on my 31st birthday.
Oh, 31. I remember when I was that young.
Wasn't that like 4 years ago, 5 years ago?
500 years ago. I'm gonna make the joke now.
According to that one person... We thought that you and your father were brothers.
Yeah, I remember that. That was super fun. Now we're starting to look more like brothers. So feel the pain, my friend. You've fully gotten into your 30s. Enjoy it, because it doesn't get better.
Now I can't pretend I'm 29. Still great.
No, when you reach 31, you can no longer pretend you're in your 20s.
Yeah, 30 is just late 20s. Come on, guys.
Yeah, you never really turn 40. You're just in your 30s forever.
Yeah, I believe that.
But anyway, on your very special birthday episode that we are doing at the moment...
We're having cake.
We are having cake? Well, we're having virtual cake.
Virtual cake.
Yes. The cake is a lie. That's what I've heard.
That's true.
Yeah, also true. Aperture Science. We do what we must because we can. But on this episode, we wanted to talk a little bit about 2019. We have now reached our 200th episode and passed it.
Wow.
I don't know how we did that.
Carefully, patience, perseverance.
Yeah. And
mind-numbingly large amount of audio editing on your half, I assume.
Yeah, yeah, there was a lot of that. You know, just bullheaded stubbornness. I think was part of that.
Probably a lot of that, too.
Coming into 2019, which is just around the corner, we thought we'd sit down and we'd talk a little bit about, you know, what the show has in store for the new year, or what we'd like to do with the show coming
up. And maybe we can talk about some of the stuff we've actually done, too.
Oh, yes, we should.
Because, for instance, 200 episodes is about 52 episodes a year. Normally, this year, we were just talking, and we did double up back in, I think, March. We had a March Madness, like,
yeah,
just
March.
a ton of episodes out.
So
like
many.
Like, twice a week for, like, 4 weeks or something.
Yeah.
But 200 puts us at, this will be our fifth year doing the show?
We're going to be going into our fifth year soon.
Going into our fifth year.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy.
When we started, how many episodes did you think we would go to?
Oh, geez, I don't know. When we started, we were doing it bi-weekly, and we had hour-long episodes.
That's true.
And then we went to weekly, half-hour episodes, give or take, to hopefully try and make it more bite-sized so people could have the attention span that would be like, oh, all right, this has been going on way too long.
Right, because you're never sure, like, if people are going to look at, like, hour-and-a-half-long episodes, which is usually what we ended up recording, and think, oh, God.
It's 2 hours of Alex and Nathan. Hooray!
Yeah, we might not... We can get more bite-sized chunks, so we went back to trying to break it up more so that you had more bite-sized pieces condensed. I mean, I guess the answer is we can do it for a good long time.
Yeah, we can do it for at least... 4 years? 5 years?
Yeah, we can do it going into 5 years now. And, you know, we've been able to have some really great guests on and
we
meet some wonderful people. This year, probably more exciting than most previous years. We had bigger names on the show than we have previously.
Right. We had crazy big names, I want to say.
Yeah.
Comparatively to other years. Not that all of our friends on the show are small names necessarily, but Rudy and Satine and Matt Leacock.
I know we had Matt Leacock on the show. It seems weird to even say, but
you know. Then like Jeff Tidball too. So we had at least two like AAA game designers on the show this year.
Yeah, yeah.
Plus someone who works for Wizards of the Coast now. We've had quite a few interesting and amazing people on.
Oh yeah,
over the years in general.
But in terms of, I guess, general name recognition, we had some pretty big people on the show this year, and we were really, really happy about that. But, so let's talk about what we're going to do come the new year.
We're going to get drunk watching the ball drop.
Okay.
Actually, no, I'm probably working New Year's Eve, so that's a lie.
So you're probably not going to be doing that.
I'll probably be at work.
Technically, though, that's this year.
That is this year, yeah. Correct.
Sorry. Next year, 2019.
I'll still be at work.
Okay, that's fair enough. So, you know, we've been talking a little bit, and I think we want to do something a little bit differently come 2019.
We want to go crazy, everybody.
Yes. Well, we are going to do that. So something that worried me throughout the year, and I guess it's just been a little bit more prevalent than in previous years. Like, we had March Madness. You were talking about, like, March in, I think, even April. We were doubling up. We had a lot of people that were coming on to talk about Kickstarters and projects that they were doing. We're always happy to have a lot of guests on the show, and we're, you know, we're always interested in meeting new people, but there is a point where it starts to feel like every episode becomes like a commercial for someone. We didn't want to just do that going forward.
Yeah.
Because it does feel like, you know, we have people that listen. And, you know, they come here to hopefully get a little informed, hopefully a little entertained, and to get something out of the experience. We didn't really want to just continually sell stuff to them when people come on to promote things. So I think we're going to start moving a little bit more away from that and do some different kinds of content. For instance... Alex, you had kind of talked a little bit about some other subjects that are around gaming that interested you, that you wanted to eventually talk about on the show. Can you get a little bit of information for us?
Well, first of all, I wanted to clarify the previous statement a little bit more. Basically, the consensus between both Nathan and I here was that we love to do interviews and we love to talk about games. Mm-hmm. That is something that we've obviously been doing for like 4 years now. We started just with David Somerville just because it was sounded fun. Oh, yeah. David is a friend and we're like, hey, yeah, come, we'll talk about the mechanics of your game that you're working on. Mm-hmm. And then it turned into doing like interviews almost exclusively, right?
Yeah.
But somewhere down the line, it changed from just talking about games and doing interviews about the design and the mechanics to... I feel like if we were to do a percentage, it would probably be like probably 80% of the games that we talk about now are games that are either coming up on a Kickstarter or have a Kickstarter or want you to know about their Kickstarter.
Right.
And so right. It's probably been a good 2-3 years now.
Yeah, 2 years or more.
At least like 2 years. And I mentioned to Nathan how it feels like all we're doing is just... trying to sell stuff.
Right.
And that's not fun for us because it feels like we want our audience, our listeners, you guys, to spend money that not necessarily everyone has on games where that isn't our intent and we're not getting paid to advertise said games. And there are plenty of other outlets out there and podcasts and review services that do that, that get paid to talk about a game, talk it up, and basically sell you on their product. That's not what we do.
Right.
Like, I've made it clear to designers over the last couple of years, like, when they've talked to us and it showed interest, it's like, we don't do reviews. Right. We'll talk about your game with you. We'll talk about the design of your game. Mm. We'll talk about the lore of your game. But we're not going to review your game. We're not going to give our audience an opinion on whether they should buy it or whether they should back it. We will deliver to you guys what the game is, how it's played, the mechanics behind it, because we are still primarily, I want to say in at least thought, a mechanics-based podcast.
Right.
Because that's how we started, and that's what interests me about gaming. Mm-hmm. And so as I say this, it's Nathan and I both just come to the realization that trying to sell games and doing all this with the interviews and doing it where Nathan spends hours. I don't even want to calculate the hours Nathan spends audio editing for the show.
Yeah, it's
especially on shows that we get on tangents that doesn't get used.
Yeah,
You know, Nathan's not getting paid for this. I know we have a Patreon. We have four backers.
We have four.
I think now.
Yes, we have four. Yes,
and we love all four of you.
Oh yes, trust us. We do.
But Nathan is not getting paid to edit the show. And he puts in way more hours into the show than I do, and way more hours from his free time to do it. And I personally feel like, Nathan, if you're going to put this many hours into the show, it's a job for you. And if it's a job for you, you should be making money doing it. Where we're doing promos for games.
Right.
And it's not a paid promo for a game. We would want to do something that we have fun with.
Right.
Which is what this comes down to.
Right. And that kind of gets us down to, like, what we've been talking about doing. And I think some of the things that we've been discussing, I think was just, like, wouldn't it be great if, like, we could just do more shows where it is just the two of us? Because I went back and I looked at this last year, and I think I calculated really just three episodes where it was just the two of us talking. Actually, if I were to do a breakdown for you, one of those was the episode we did at the very beginning of the year where we were talking about what we wanted to do for 2018. One of them was Good Housekeeping, where we were discussing season four of the show, and we did like an update for Patreon and Kickstarter projects and stuff like that. And then the one episode where we actually got around to talking about something substantial in tabletop gaming with us was D&D 5e and Me, where I talked about my first experience playing 5e.
Right.
That was really the only episode, even after those, where we really sat down and talked about tabletop gaming specifically. I feel like there's a lot of things that really excite us about gaming that we really geek out about, that we really enjoy talking about, and we just really haven't had the opportunity to do that very much.
Right, and I think some of our live shows, which, by the way,
awesome.
I would like to try and get in the habit of doing those like once a month.
Figure out a time where we can just set up a standard date every month and do it, because you gotta love those.
Yes, they're fun, and DC always joins us, and usually a couple other people. Jake from Nerdolopedia will join us once in a while,
yeah,
and Drunk
see,
Paul
yeah,
will join us once in a while
see
as
Drunk
well.
Paul,
and it's really fun.
Yeah.
If you guys haven't seen, listened to, or joined us on our live shows, they can be a lot of fun. They're not strictly tabletop gaming, they're just gaming and chatting. And
no, because I usually use it as an excuse to talk about video games as long as I possibly can.
Or we play video games, like we'll play Don't Starve together and fail terribly.
Yeah.
Or we'll play golf with your friends get people to rage quit.
That did happen, didn't it?
I want to say it happened.
Yeah, it did happen that one time.
Once or twice.
Because we were nowhere near as good as somebody else, and I think they got tired of playing.
I think the game crashed.
Maybe the game rage quit on us. I'm not sure.
The game went, rah!
You know, we have a lot of fun doing those, and they are a lot more freeform, but you actually get to sit down and talk to people. That kind of reminds me of what we originally started as, a show where we just sat down and we just talked about games.
Which is fun.
Yeah. And it was a ton of fun for us. And I feel like 4 years in, you know, both of us have a lot more experience and a lot more knowledge about the scope of gaming.
That is true. Nathan, you are no longer a game newbie as much as you are a physically a game newbie.
Yeah.
As in, you have not played a lot of games still necessarily.
Right.
But you know a lot more about how games work.
I do. And even now, I am playing in a 5e campaign, which is Ta-da! Scary in itself.
I mean, it is. You still don't take it seriously, but that's just you.
I'm a giant turtle. We're going to be having a fun live play that you're going to be hearing on this show, hopefully soon, over the holidays. That's a little bit different, but we'll talk about that in a minute. But yeah, I've gotten a lot more into that, and also, like, just hearing so many different people's accounts, especially when we have people that are already established in the industry, talk about different systems and different things that they did, just gives me a lot more information about, you know, what you can do with games when you want to. Once upon a time, when we just talked about mechanics, and then we later just talked about design, we didn't necessarily just get into games that we were playing and what we liked about them, or things that were just really exciting for us at that time in that moment. And I feel like we should be talking about that, because if it's exciting for us, we should really do something with that. We really should talk about that stuff. It's important.
Yeah, and our excitement usually bleeds off into the podcast to make it seem more exciting.
Yes.
Because, as you know, with like shows and stuff, if you see someone excited about something, mm-hmm. genuinely excited,
yes,
then you know they like it, you know they're having fun with it, and generally that's a better experience for the user, right, or the listener, or the viewer,
right?
Because it doesn't just feel forced. Not that we feel forced.
No, we don't. But we do want to be able to say, like, every time we get into a show, we just want to be super jazzed that we're doing a show. And there have been times, this is where we get 100% real, where I was like, oh, we got to do a show. And I was not super jazzed to do it. And I was like, oh, we got to think of something that we can do for the show this week. That's usually not good. You want to be able to be happy that you're doing the show all the time. To get the excitement back, we thought that it was kind of a good idea to kind of get back to basics. Not that we won't have guests. I'm sure that we will.
We would still love to have guests.
Oh, yeah. Maybe.
Maybe not every single week.
Yeah. Maybe not every
single
week.
And definitely not every show that we have a guest telling you that, hey, we've got a Kickstarter to talk about.
Not every time talking about crowdsourcing. And it actually got me back to thinking about something else, because at the very beginning of the year, someone, actually it was DC, had given me a list of different people that he said, you should really have these people on the show, and I contacted a few of them, and generally, you know, we got a pretty good response back from that. But some of the guests that he had suggested were just, they were people that are in tabletop gaming, but I just didn't know if it was in a realm or an aspect of tabletop gaming that would make sense for the show. But now I keep thinking, but I kind of want to know more about that. When he had suggested, you know, this is somebody, they're really good at like live action role playing, they know a lot about that, or this is somebody who is really great at creating actual props and objects that you can use in tabletop gaming, scrolls, and actually how to create those so that your players have it. I keep thinking to myself now, well, now I kind of want to know about those things. That actually sounds pretty great. And maybe it would be good to just kind of like reach a little bit outside of our comfort zone that we got into and try a few different things. But I mean, you've been talking a little bit too, I'll pass it on to you, about some things that are interesting you now in gaming that you wanted to talk more about.
What specifically? There's a lot of things.
Specifically, I'm thinking of, like, serials and ARGs.
Oh, yeah. I'm definitely, I know I talked about, like, Bend Around, for instance, on one of our live shows. Oh, yeah. That was our Halloween live show.
Yeah.
I've been interested in that field for a little bit now as well. And at some point, I would like to try and get somebody that's made a decent ARG on the show to talk about. Mm. ARG being alternate reality gaming, not augmented reality gaming.
There is a
difference. There's a bit of a disambiguation right there.
They're both ARGs, but
like, that's something that's been interesting me for a bit, but I've also been frustrated with as well. I'm not going to get super into that right now. I've just been frustrated, like, in this scene for that is mostly just, like, web series and not alternate reality games,
right,
but they present themselves as an alternate reality game, but there's no game there.
I gotcha.
Anyways.
Yeah. But I mean, even in terms of what that means for like narrative structure and all of that, you know, that's interesting stuff that I'm not very familiar with, but I would be interested if we could talk more about that. And it's just, it feels not quite in the same realm as tabletop gaming, but I think it's actually pretty pertinent.
Right.
So things like that are just, they're things that we have not typically talked about on the show but I feel deserve some attention. And, like, over the course of the last 4 years, like, not just played some RPGs, but have played more board games that some of them people are familiar with, some of them maybe not. But when I do, I kind of want to talk about what I liked about it. I kind of want to talk about mechanics that I was not aware of and what the experience was to play it. And again, we really haven't had the time or the format to do that because we've been talking about a lot of other things in the meantime. Being able to have people on or to discuss those things specifically would definitely be enjoyable, I know, for me and hopefully for everybody else that's listening.
I think one of the other things, too, it's where you were mentioning narrative structure and whatnot. Being able to go more into the lore of games would be fun as well.
Oh, yes.
Maybe not as Delve itself, but maybe Delve's spinoff series, because we have several ideas for other shows.
Oh, yes. And
kicking around. Oh, boy, do we have other ideas for shows and content. The problem with that is just we need the time.
Yeah, and I'm not...
And the energy, or maybe another person on board to help us out with them.
Possibly. And
if you're interested in becoming part of a Delve team with us, let us know.
Let us know. Yeah, and it's not like those series might be like every week series. They might just be like monthly series or something, but...
Bi-weekly, or they could be Patreon exclusive, because that's apparently how you get patrons. Plug, patron. Our Patreon level is $1.
Our Patreon level is $1. You get all of the additional like content and the unedited episodes and stuff. But before we talk about those other projects, though, one other thing that I wanted to do coming up on the new season of Delve, I actually want to go back to the well and revisit some old topics that we actually discussed originally on the show, because I feel like we have a lot more knowledge about things like experience systems and hit points and things that we talked about in the very early days of Delve that we can have a much better conversation around now.
Oh, because you know more about them now.
Well, I do, but I mean, you can probably admit that being familiar with a bunch of new systems that maybe you weren't before gives you some more information on those subjects too.
Yes, I've gained invaluable information in game design over the last 4 years as well.
Right, and so I think that we actually have better conversations that we can have revolving around that, and talk about the different ways that they're implemented and if it works for us and in what context. So being able to kind of revisit those subjects would be really useful for me. Like, right now, I'm just thinking about a conversation I think we can really have based around the experience point system versus milestones in 5e.
Yes.
Because I've only actually played games where milestone was the thing you do. I really like it, and I think that there's a real case to be made for and against the traditional experience systems.
I will tell you right now, the games I was playing with David and Bo.
Mm-hmm.
Started out as experience system, and then David kind of switched us into like kind of milestone or similar.
Yeah.
On this exact topic, the feeling of getting experience is great, but the feeling of not having to keep track of experience and knowing that you've done something monumental to earn a level or two, they're two different feelings.
Right.
They're completely different. Experiences.
Yeah, and I feel like there's a longer episode that we could go into where we discuss that.
I mean, we could talk about it right now, but we're not going
We're not going to, but, you know, at least now we kind of know one of the first things we got to talk about. I think that might be one of the first episodes we had to do for the new year. So some other projects that we've had kicking around in our head. You've been talking about eventually doing some kind of a serial or an ARG yourself.
Yeah, I mean, we can talk about that, too. One of the ideas I had a while ago was a show. I started listening to Welcome to Night Vale last year, and no lies, I love it. It presents itself in a way that is serious but silly. The show takes itself completely seriously. It is dedicated to what it is. In that vein, I had thought of what would you call it? It wasn't really a news show, but it was kind of a news show.
Yeah, I mean, well, I guess what might help first is, can you just explain briefly, like, what is Welcome to Night Vale for people who haven't
listened to Welcome to Night Vale? It is a podcast that takes place in the fictional town of Night Vale, where every conspiracy theory is true, and it is a local radio station. So you get your community radio host, Cecil Palmer. Cecil Baldwin is the person that voices Cecil Palmer.
Oh, okay. I get you.
And he's bringing you the community news for the town of Night Vale, which does not actually exist. But it presents itself in the way that it is a place that exists. This is real news in Night Vale, and it doesn't take itself as, like, just a joke. There are jokes, there are running gags throughout the show. They set up things months and months and months and months and months in advance, sometimes years in advance. But there's an overarching plot to points of it. There are different parts in the show that go together that you can hear from one episode to an episode 30 down, mm-hmm. where it comes back again. There's lots of interesting themes and really interesting storytelling in Night Vale.
I guess the elevator pitch you made to me is, well, what if you had something that was like Welcome to Night Vale, but it revolved around, like, actual live plays, actual plays of people's games, and if all of those PCs and their adventures and their worlds were real.
Right. That's essentially what I said to you. So, as Nathan just said, the idea is you have a host character who lives in a space that every fictional reality is real. Every setting for D&D, all the other RPG settings that are out there are actual places in the multiverse that exist. But this person is like the keeper of knowledge, or like something. He's a keeper, a collector, a repository of news events and whatnot that happen.
Yeah, I kind of imagined it almost like, kind of like how the TARDIS exists in a pocket universe.
So basically, it's this dude, or this girl, doesn't matter. The idea was that it was an Asimar, potentially, some celestial being, that gets all this information in from all the multiverse of all the RPG realms that are real to him. So what's he do with that information? Well, he distributes it a little bit indiscriminately. So he has this show, whether or not it's sci-fi or not, not the point. The point is in the disbelief you suspend there, where he has this thing that he tells the news, and it'll present itself to you in whatever format your timeline is able to receive. So it could be a newsletter if you're in a fantasy game, or it could be a straight beamed into your brain in sci-fi, or a podcast in modern.
Right, right.
So that would be how we get it, of course, because we're modern times.
Exactly.
But where he tells you the news going on, and this would revolve around potentially the live plays that people do, right, big and small, because there's a bajillion of them. So it would be kind of like a recap of some of these shows and some of the exploits the characters get into, but there could be different segments. So it could be like, all right, this week in the heroes who saved a princess category of our show, we have these people from this location who did this and defeated this bad guy and saved this princess. Or it could be like, here are the worst criminals of the week, where you have stories that you've gotten from people about their characters doing nefarious deeds. You could do things like that, but where there's such an expansive player base that likes to share stories of what their characters do and what their villains do and what their games entail.
Right.
There's an almost inexhaustible source of material to pull from there.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And the idea of, you know, a character that treats it all as if it were indeed real, you know, it is, it's real for them. And treating it as if all of these essentially fictitious worlds that we play in are legit real. I just found very interesting.
Like, this stuff is really happening. Yeah. That guy really slayed a dragon.
Yeah.
That dragon really ate that group of peasants. Just think of it from a news standpoint.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if you hear about all that stuff, you go, oh, wow.
When you gave me that concept, I was like, I can see that.
And I've kicked it around to a couple people, and they're like, that sounds really cool.
And everyone that has heard that idea seemed more than agreeable toward that idea.
I know everyone that listens to our show will hear this idea, so please let us know if you think it's a cool idea, because we could potentially pursue it. The biggest hurdle for that one is we need the resources.
Mm.
Live plays are free to listen to, generally speaking.
Right.
And there's a ton of, there's like RPG horror stories on Reddit where you could pull information from as well.
Oh, yeah.
To retell other people's stories, right. Assuming that is permissible.
I mean, we talked to like one or two people just to say, hey, would it be cool if we, you know, used stuff from you? And they actually seem pretty agreeable to that idea and seem to like it. So with everybody's, you know, support, encouragement, and permission, we would do that. But the big hurdle, I think, what you're getting at is getting all that information, because that's a lot of research and time in, and right. and putting the actual show together for a finished product.
Right. It would involve audio editing from Nathan.
Yep.
Because the idea was to actually have a show that sounded like a radio show.
Right.
With sound effects and whatnot, mm-hmm. which we probably have access to sound effects, but you still need to get it in there and have it sound the way you want it to, so we need to figure out the pilot and whatnot.
Right.
You have a host who's got a voice that fits for it,
mm-hmm.
But is also good at delivering red lines. Because not just freeform like this, they could still read it and freeform it a bit,
mm-hmm.
but you'd need to do some script writing. So it would involve a lot of writing, which I've been trying to get back into. It's hard because I haven't done it in a while. If I had a push to do that, I could definitely try it. Or if someone else would like to try and help write it too. Again, we don't get paid. But
right.
But potentially if that show kicks off, I feel like it could be something that eventually does gain traction in a lot of listeners, yeah. like way more than Delve does.
It possibly. And you know, the thing about it is, I think the biggest part of that is we'd have to crowdsource the actual data. We kind of have to have people that religiously like listen to different live plays or podcasts that could give us like interesting things that actually happened in them, because I don't have the time to listen to everything. It's physically impossible to do.
Yeah.
I need recaps or people that can give me some recaps or something.
We recap three caps.
We three cap.
But that's just one idea like I've had kicking around. And then between Nathan and I, we both had other ideas kicking around.
Oh, yes. Should I tell them the one like off the hand thought I had? Before we...
Yes.
Yeah, okay, cool. So I had the idea for a show because Alex, literally, I'll give you this information. Literally, you said, you have any other ideas for shows? And like, I sat there for a few minutes and I was like, ooh, one thought. And I pitched a show called Power Surge.
Oh yeah, this was recent. Yeah,
this was real recent. And so the idea of Power Surge was, it kind of combines the tabletop realm, but with something that I'm much more familiar with, which is video games. But this particular show actually revolves around the idea of, what if you wanted to play a video game, but there's a power surge, now your power is off, could you turn that video game into a tabletop game?
Yeah, it's less narrative than the last idea, but...
Oh, it's much more freeform, but, you know, you would then sit there and think to yourself, what kind of form would that take? What are the mechanics that you would utilize? Because the one thing that I thought of immediately after, very shortly in the mail, supposedly, Fallout 76 is going to get delivered to my door. And I'm going to sit down and I'm going to play it, and you can expect that I'll probably have an attempting to play about it. But I sat there and I thought to myself, actually, it feels like this could have been a much more set, like just the general concept that they had would have actually made a more interesting tabletop game.
Potentially.
If they had just like taken the map of Fallout 76 and they had made it like almost like if they had taken almost a pandemic model. You know, where like, oh, the radiation is coming, or the bombs are going to fall, and you need to have your team work together, because like in Fallout 76, there's no human NPCs So it's all player characters. So if you had a team and they were working together in a system like that, and they're right across the table, you can shrink that game down a little bit and, you know, kind of shrink the overall time investment. I was like, it feels like that would have actually been a more interesting play experience. But that's just like one example of like, what could you do to actually take something that is a, you know, a video game that we might be familiar with, and what kind of tabletop game would actually be in the spirit of that? What would you build? And I thought that that was just an interesting thought experiment.
All thought experiments are interesting, but yes, you know, I thought that was a really interesting idea. With the free-to-play and attempting to play games you've been playing, just to try out games, there's a lot of stuff you could look at and take as.
Oh, yeah.
And just the gaming stuff that we've had over the many, many years of gaming, video games, it's like,
oh, yeah.
How could I play that to tabletop? But the other side to that, too, is it can be a design exercise, because there are a lot of video gamers who start by first making a tabletop game, whether or not it ever gets published,
right.
But it can be like something you do in school, where they go make a tabletop game, because it introduces you to game design, and then you end up coding later. But tabletop, again, the reason I like tabletop and got into tabletop design myself is because I started going to school for video game design, and then upon realizing that there is absolutely no money in video games right now, not having time with a younger than 1 year old child working 40 hours a week and going to school full time, it did not work, and I dropped the one thing that I could, which is not work or a child. Well, I mean, you can drop a child, it's just not advisable.
It's not advisable. No, I think what you're saying is the logistics of it became unreasonable.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I think I had thought of that off the top of my head because I've had this idea for an episode of Delve for a while. That I was like, you know, given the right group of people, if we had a group of people in the room, I kind of had this idea for doing a game show, which I actually called Nathan's Mech Tech Challenge. And I was trying to get like 10 video game mechanics together that I thought, like, these would be tricky to utilize in a tabletop game. But I wonder if you got a few people together, who could come up with the best idea for how you could implement it as a tabletop game? And I guess Power Surge is kind of what came out of that.
Well, the other thing that that brings me to now is while I was talking to Bo and David the other
day,
and Bo suggested an idea that we kind of already had, but differently than we were thinking, kind of, I think.
A little bit differently,
Because I know you remember that we had an idea for a show called Bear Tank.
Oh, yes.
Which is like Shark Tank.
But with bears.
But with bears, because us. Because I killed a bear once.
Right, we remember that. And not in a game, in real life.
I know we remember it. You never shut up about it. So I had to get that out there so you didn't have to.
Yes.
So the idea for Bear Tank was we get a couple game designers in like a live show format, maybe. And we go, hey, either we get people, someone who's working on a game and needs help.
Yeah.
Or just wants to kind of rattle off ideas and talk about the ideas and like work on it.
Right.
In a show setting where we can just like, I've got this idea for design. Let's hammer out the details. So it's kind of a live show where you can see how a game is made kind of deal.
Right. Because we kind of end up doing that on every show anyway. When people come on, we give them at least 10 terrible suggestions and then like one where they go, huh.
It's fun for me because I like to do game design. I love mechanic design. Mm. Ask me to make a game mechanic for you and I will. Just throwing that out there. but where we've got that concept, Bo threw out the concept of what if you take, what was it, obscure design ideas like, and mechanic ideas?
Yeah, like elements of a game. Just like a singular element.
And you make a game out of it. So say you have to use a spinner and you have to make your game based around that. Or for instance, we have like, we select some weird topics or like, here's a topic, here's a mechanic, and here's another thing, make a game. Could we do it? And Nathan specifically has learned a lot about game design over the last 4 years. And I've learned a lot more as well than I already knew. And so between us and then probably a guest or two, can we design a game that could be made with the show?
And I think that that's a really interesting concept, like working from a singular point that may not be particularly easy to work from, could you actually flesh out a full, unique gaming experience from it?
And it wouldn't necessarily have to do lore. I mean, we could do lore, but the gaming experience would be the mechanics and the design. How would the game function? How would it play?
Sure.
We'd have to set up the rules of our show to, you have to have a concept, you have to have a conflict resolution mechanic, or a movement mechanic or whatever. We'd have to figure out the elements of gaming that we need in order to call ourselves a success or a failure of that show.
Yeah, there'd be like a checklist of these. Yeah. We'd have to meet
a checklist of things. Be like, all right, so we got this, but we couldn't get that, whatever.
Right.
But it could be fun. And we could also do that in a live show format as well, because we could host it on Discord, or we could do it on Twitch and live stream it. We could have audience input.
Right.
Because then it could be the designers or the people in the room talking, but also taking idea suggestions from people that are watching.
Right. I kind of felt like probably like a 4-person panel is probably the most ideal. And it doesn't have to be the same 2 people every time in addition to us, but to have at least 2 other voices in it. And if we could do it like on a video chat and then stream it, and then people could join us on Discord, Twitch, whatever, and throw in ideas or suggestions. We could look at them. We could mull over those ideas, kind of brainstorm as a community experience.
So there's 3 other show ideas we have right there.
Yeah.
One of them requires a lot more scripting.
Right.
A lot more effort.
One's more of a scripted series. And then 2 more are kind of conceptual ideas that are about building games.
And since our whole thing is game design, I like that. And since I think the people that listen to us enjoy game design, they might like that too.
But I assume if you're listening to this show, you do. And then there is, of course, the other thing that's kind of... that I continually talk about, and if people are to be believed, we're just waiting to figure out the logistics of doing it, which is the Hoof and Horn Detective Agency and Snowball the Rainbow Unicorn, that whole live play
eventually
kind of thing.
We would like to do like a live play.
A live play series.
Or a one shot. Or maybe we can start doing live plays, actual plays.
That's true.
Doesn't matter if it's live or actual or just the show that we have, games that have been played with us.
I kept thinking to myself, like, the thing that I thought would be very interesting about the whole idea of the Hoof and Horn Detective Agency that I've talked about is not just the idea of playing monsters, because I kind of like that idea. You don't see it very much. But I've seen a lot of live plays that are comedic. I've seen a lot of live plays that are like dramatic and ones that are like horror based. But I have really not seen a lot of live plays that were really about like a mystery. Like at like an actual detective show where you're trying to solve a case or something like that, a whodunit. Yeah. And I kind of like the idea. It feels like that doesn't get done very much, and that's kind of what I thought was the general theme.
I feel like a large portion of the live and actual play stuff that is out there, a lot of it is comedic. And as much as I love a good silly game, I've been spoiled by David, where his game was not silly. His game had some really, had some dark moments, and it was just great.
Right.
Like, it wasn't out to be a silly game. It was a game that was serious, but the characters that Bo and I made ended up giving levity to situations and ended up creating the parts that were silly. But not because their characters were silly, but because they were kind of out of place in the world.
You've also been spoiled by not playing with me. Because
that's not going to lie, Nathan. As much as I really want a game with you, oh boy.
You know how that's going to end up, right?
I know exactly how it'll turn out, which is why it's like, I would love to play a game with Nathan, but I know he's not going to take anything seriously in this game, and I'm just going to go, sigh. Well,
so I'm playing a game right now with Dominic Perry. Dominic Perry, of course, one of our great Patreon people, and of course the head of 9 Dragons, which I am playing with a terrific group of people that are, that have worked in the industry, so I feel like I'm, among some form of royalty in gaming, but we're all playing characters in a storyline that is, by its very nature, not supposed to be funny. Like it's not by design funny. But some of our characters and the way they interact with the world do things that are very funny.
Yes. And see, I do enjoy that, because if the players are the ones that make the humor, mm-hmm. I think it's way better than if it's a dungeon master.
Right.
Who's trying to pull punches and make it just kind of chuckle.
Right.
Chuckle.
Right.
Because you can write humor into a game. You mm-hmm. can make it hilarious. But ultimately, yeah. it's what the players do that make it funny or not.
And, I keep thinking, my character is Rembrandt, and he is he's a teenager, and he's a mutant, and he's a shadow monk, so essentially a ninja, and he's a turtle.
So he's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle?
Very good. And he's, and I made him abnormally large and abnormally heavy, because that's part of his mutation. So he glows green. So basically I made him the least stealth character imaginable. And so by nature, it's a little hard to take him seriously, but at the same time, I realize that there are deeper drives to him, that like, he still really wants to be a ninja, and he's just really handicapped in that ability to do so, because he has physical limitations, and the fact that he glows makes it difficult for him to do that, but he wants to overcome it. So he's still kind of like naive. He's lived in a temple his whole life, and so everything's new and fresh to him, and he's a teenager, so he wants to experience all that, but he still wants to live up to his training and be like an actual shadow monk who does actual shadow monk things. So he does have like a deeper storyline, but he's also just really funny for the fact that he seems so out of place. Like, even when I talk about like Snowball the Rainbow Unicorn, like that seems ridiculous, but he legitimately wants to be a great detective like the ones he's read about. And hopefully, like, when we actually get around to playing with him a little bit more, you'll kind of see how that manifests.
Right.
But, you know, so I like to do comedic characters that have great comedic moments, but, like, in long run, have a bigger story arc. You know, I find that enjoyable in the long term. But at the end of the day, like, when Dom creates a character called Too Fast, and I have to ask if they know a character named Too Furious, because I have to. It's like, I cannot help that. Being able to actually do a live play for the site would be terrific, and I'd like to be able to do that at some point. And if it gets to be the Hoof and Horn Detective Agency, I know some people that are really jazzed about that idea, and hopefully we'll get to do that in the new year. Other thing I wanted to just touch on was the future of some other existing things that I do for DelveCast, because going into the new year, I'm realizing at some point I'm going to have to go and do, what's it called? A job to make, what's it called? Money. So I'm probably going to have to restructure some things, because I just won't have quite as much time. So some of the series that I do, like Attempting to Play. So Attempting to Play has evolved, I think, quite a bit since I originally started it. And I've gotten interested in different things since I, like, started doing it. Like, I originally started it out to be, like, a series of funny Let's Play videos that I cut together. In more recent episodes, I have actually started asking a question about games. Like, actually asking questions about games. And now that I'm doing that, I feel like it might not really be that, maybe that's a different series that I should start doing instead of Attempting to Play, because it feels like that's a different kind of format. But I really like the idea of, like, when you go into a game and you've played that game, is there a lesson you take away from that? Is there a question that you asked yourself that maybe this game answers?
Aside from, like, why did I play this piece of garbage?
Well, like, for instance, when this comes out, the Attempting to Play would have come out just recently for We Happy Few, which was a game that I really did in, like, I was really excited about. And then like, I started seeing early reviews where they were like, oh my god, it's such a buggy mess. And I couldn't believe if that was really true or not. And then after playing it, I was like, huh, interesting. And I started to ask a question, which I try to answer in that video, which is there such a thing as a junk food video game? Essentially, like, the game that you know is bad, that you shouldn't really play, but you keep playing it anyway, because I played it for so long.
Right.
Even though I knew, yeah, there's so many problems with this. And so I kind of talked more about, like, what is that, and, you know, is this a trap that you've fallen into, and looked back at some other games that kind of fall into that category too, where you know there's another game that's in the same genre that would be so much better for you to play, you'd enjoy it a lot more, but you're still playing this thing like it's, like you got the bag of Cheetos in your lap, and you're like, I know that there's a delicious steak dinner in the fridge, but I'm gonna eat this damn bag of cheesy poofs.
I'm gonna eat this whole thing if it kills me.
Right, exactly. So I've been asking questions about that. Like, I did No Man's Sky. I was asking, like, can a game be too big? Because I really yes. started to feel like after that game, yeah.
I definitely, not to get on that topic for a while, but yeah, I definitely have played games that I feel could be better played on a smaller scale.
Right. And I even kind of talked about, you know, if they had just sized that back so maybe it was only like a tenth, like a 100th of the amount of space and everything was closer together, you know, I think it would have been a better play experience.
I've said this before about big space games like that, like even Elite Dangerous, but scale right. it down.
Yeah.
No, really.
Yeah.
Scale it down.
Yeah.
Because they're going to decrease the amount of time spent from point A to point B doing nothing. The reason they skip space travel in movies, yeah. Nathan, you know the reason they skip it?
Because it's boring?
Because it's really boring.
It's really boring, yeah.
It's really boring. Even moving at past the speed of light, mm-hmm. space travel is really boring.
I got that all over the place when I was playing No Man's Sky, because that's so much of what you're doing is walking or you know, traveling through open space. It's a lot of what you do to get to actual stuff.
Especially interstellar space.
But I mean, it's not... It's, not to get on too much of a tangent, but even when I see, like, the open world games, and, like, they're going, this next installment of the series is 4 times the size of the last one. It's like, okay, but is there 4 times the content that I'm going to want to play?
Right.
Is that amount of space utilized to some degree where I am going to get enjoyment out of it? Because if you're just increasing the size for me to have more downtime in the game, I don't want it. So if you're just going to, you know, increase the size of the map, but just spread more stuff out, that's not really fun. I played Red Dead Redemption 2, and it is considerably larger than the original Red Dead Redemption, but at every turn, there's stuff. So they utilized it. And so it justifies its existence. So, you know, that's fine. That's fine. But if you're just going to make it gigantic for the sake of making it gigantic, it feels like you're just making it a grind fest that I don't want to get into. So it feels like I've started to ask a lot more questions about it, and I don't necessarily feel like that's the same series. So maybe I'll do a different kind of series where I have a better structure, where I explain right up at the front that we're going to explore a question on this episode with this game as our example, and we might do something more like that. Orbital, probably toward the beginning of the year, you're going to see a little bit of a break. There are a few episodes that I want to do going through the end of the year and like in January, but it takes me a while to put a lot of stuff together for Orbital. So I have to, you know, write a lot of stuff for it too. I'll probably be kind of like taking yet another little bit of a break, before I come back to it. So you can expect that. Now, Tales from the Spam Folder, you'll probably occasionally see those pop up, because the great thing about that show is, the content comes to me. I will never run out of content for Tales of the Spam Folder, because every day I look, it's like Christmas. It is just Christmas every freaking time. I'm like, man, your gift horse, mouth, me. Just, I can't make this stuff up. So once in a while you might see that. And if I can keep setting it to classical music to make you feel fancy while you're watching it, I will. You'll have another episode that actually comes out, like, on Christmas, which is set to Waltz of the Flowers. So enjoy that. It'll be nice and Christmassy for you. And for people that are interested in what we're doing for the rest of the year, as I was saying earlier in the show, we are actually going to be doing a one-shot, recording a one-shot very shortly, thanks to some help from one of the people that we've had on the show before, and hopefully some people that are, you know, friends of the show that you've heard before, and some new friends, where we're going to do kind of like a holiday version of a one-shot that will probably run over a few weeks, because it's gonna go for hours, so expect that over the holidays. You may also see a small break at the very beginning of the year for Delve, just as we kind of think about, like, what we're going to do with all that stuff that we were just talking about. So you'll see some of that. And so there might be a slight hiatus, but it probably will not be particularly long, as we kind of restructure and just work on what we're planning on doing. Hopefully get ahead of the game.
So as you sat here and listened to us ramble on about what we'd love to do with the show going forward, we would love if any of you listening gave us your input.
Yes.
We'd love if you wrote to us in Discord. Link is always in the description. Or if you reach out to us on Twitter, on Nathan or mine, or DelveCast. If you want to email us any of your thoughts on any of the stuff that we've talked about, if you like how the show's been, if you think we're moving in a good direction, if you think I'm ugly, if you think Nathan needs to get a deeper voice so he matches me, whatever.
God.
Whatever your thoughts are, we would love to hear about it.
Yeah.
So we don't really hear a lot of feedback from our listeners as often as we would like, which, you know, you're busy. You're probably not sitting at your computer 24/7,
right?
You know, typing a response. Most people, I feel, don't listen to podcasts sitting at their computer or, you know, like, sitting on their phone.
That's true.
And I get it. It's fine. But we would love some feedback on this, because we have those ideas for shows. If you want to hear any of them, if you think one sounds interesting, we'd love to hear about it. We'd love to hear your thoughts, because then it gives us more incentive to do them.
You can also, you know, comment in the posts to our episodes.
Yeah, you can comment on the site. That's always open to you. Again, Discord, email, Twitter are also all available if you want. Facebook as well. Yep. I believe we still have a Facebook page.
Yep, we have a Facebook page at DelveCast, and we have our email at DelvePodcast@gmail.com. So we check that pretty regularly.
We would just love to hear feedback from you, or if you like the ideas that we have and you want to be on the show. Like, if you want to be someone that helps us once in a while try and design a game, or if you want to do a live play with us, or if you want to play a game, or if you just want to do a lore dump of a system you're making on us and talk about it on the show.
Right.
Or if you want to talk design, or if you want to, like, help out around here and make your own show.
Oh, yes.
Or something, some content.
Yeah.
We're open to all sorts of things.
Yeah, if you have an idea for a show, feel free to pitch it to us, because I'm always interested in what people would like to put out there in the realm, and if it's something that we could host, that we'd like to host, more power to you.
And I mean, I've expressed before, once in a while, that, yeah, I'd love to grow the Delve team. I would love to have more content on the site. I'd love to have a bigger network than just Nathan.
Right, right. Because right now, let me tell you, this is it. it's whatever the
Nathan
two of us can come up with. That's it.
And Nathan does most of it, because he does Orbital by himself and he does his Attempting Play series by himself.
At the end of the day, like, I'm really enthusiastic about some of the other show ideas that we have, and I want to be able to do them. But in terms of, like, just the overall structure, anything else, there's only so many shows that I can put together in a week.
Yeah.
So, you know, if you have an idea for a show, or you have ideas for subjects you'd like us to tackle on the show, since we're, you know, going to be doing hopefully a lot more episodes, just the two of us talking about a subject, please let us know, because we would love to address any of those subjects that you'd like to go into. I think we're better equipped now than when we started the show to actually fully explore subjects that people might have. The actual episode might bear that out, that we are not. Anywho, as always, make sure to check us out on iTunes, Google Play, and all those applications, give us stars and such.
Quick side note, we might try, we've talked about it a little bit, we might be trying to find a better hosting service that's better with analytics and better with distribution for the show. We're looking into it, because as much as archive.org is fabulously free and available forever, it's not the easiest thing to get our podcast on, say, Spotify or other podcasting apps like that are big. We would like to maybe try and get them on there so that it has a bit more visibility.
Right. Yeah, because, like, Orbital is actually done through Liberated Syndication, and so I am actually on Spotify for that. So it'd be interesting to do, but if you happen to be interested in giving us some information and, tell us, like, where you listen to the podcast, that would be really helpful.
Analytics are tough.
Analytics are really tough, because I have no idea what any of the numbers for, like, views or stuff on any particular site equates to. I don't know if that's the sum total of things. It never matches between one thing and another. I have no idea what it actually equates to.
Our best guess is there's, like, 150 of you that listen to this on the reg.
On the reg, yeah. That's
on the reg.
Our best possible guess.
That's our most adequate guess.
But at the
that's the lowest number that we are sure about.
Because for all we know, there could be a lot more, and we just don't have numbers that are showing us that.
Yeah, iTunes doesn't tell us anything as far as
iTunes has
subscribers or listeners.
iTunes is terrible for analytics.
FeedBurner gives us a rough estimate. Our website gives us, like, nothing.
Nothing. Yeah.
It gives us analytics, but honestly, the number of people that listen to it from the website seems very low.
It's pretty low comparative, but it's also not indicative of everyone who listens to the show, so it's all...
Google Play podcast analytics are just trash.
Yeah.
Despite them owning YouTube.
Which doesn't seem to make any sense, because YouTube tracks it pretty well.
Yeah.
Track analytics, it does. I look at our YouTube site, and it's like, well, you've given me breakdowns for literally everything. There's even pie charts for this. It's amazing. And usually, like, Spotify will at least give you, like, listen counts.
Right. Which would be nice.
It'd be good. It'd be good, because at least
we can look at the rough on archive as well.
Right, right, right.
So we can compare those numbers with the numbers from FeedBurner and whatnot and get a rough estimate. Yeah.
So
very, very rough estimate of how many people listen.
I think that's the big thing, is I think a lot of people probably listen through, like, iTunes or Apple Podcasts or whatever they're calling it now, and they don't have anything for analytics, so it's so difficult to find out. So if you have a specific thing that you use, if you use Spotify or iHeartRadio or anything like that to listen to podcasts, I'd be very interested to know if you can give me that information. I would like to know what that is.
Maybe we should do a survey on the website and leave it there.
Maybe we
how do you listen to our show?
Should do something, or maybe we can tweet it out too. We might be able to get something going, like, where do you listen to this
we'll
thing?
Get like four replies on that.
You know what? Four answers is better than nothing. All that said, also want to just say, if you go to the website, make sure to check out our Patreon, because that does help us keep the digital lights on. And even at support of a $1 level, any of the full unedited episodes or some of the videos that were, like, my first pass at making a video, and I was like, nah, this doesn't work. I've put up one of those already, so you might see more in the future. Even at the $1, you get all that content. It's free and available to you.
Speaking of, we would like to welcome our newest patron,
Cannibal Halfling Games.
I believe that's also known as Seamus Conley.
I'm pretty sure it's Seamus, but unless somebody else is managing his Patreon, I don't think so, though. I think it is fair to say, though, we are super excited about 2019.
We are hopeful for 2019.
We're hopeful for 2019, and we are hopeful to be excited about 2019. I can't imagine not doing the show, and...
I can. I've imagined it.
Okay. Alex has imagined it. No, I guess I have too, but I don't want to. I guess that's a better way of putting it. I don't want to imagine it. And so being able to actually do things that really excite us and talk about things that really excite us, I'm excited to get excited.
Doing stuff that we enjoy, that excites us, and we have fun doing
is good.
Means that even if no one ever actually listens to it or watches it or anything like that, we'll still enjoy it.
And I think that actually, you know, on a real creator's note at the end of this episode, if you're a creator, always plan on like making a thing that if nobody else sees it, you're going to enjoy. That's a really great way of looking at designing anything. Oh, wow. We actually had like a design moment. Like if you can design a thing that you yourself liked, you're in a good place.
Mm-hmm.
If it's at least fun for you, you know, you've made one person happy. If everybody else likes it too, icing on the cake. We're looking forward to making something that we ourselves are really, really, like, jazzed and excited and happy about doing in realms that maybe we haven't touched on before, but we're really excited to be able to do come the new year. Alex, you want to take us out on this one? You want to try to do an outro?
Outro.
It's been like 200.
Let's see, this will be like our last normal show of 2018.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's my birthday.
Yeah.
Happy birthday to me.
No, we don't have the rights. We don't have the rights to that.
No, that's legal now. The courts ruled that it's basically public domain.
Oh, perfect. Okay, well then let's sing it ad nauseum. I'm going to put it under every video.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure the courts, they finally ruled that, the song is like so just public domain that you can't claim you have the rights to it. As always, find us on iTunes, Google Play. Our website is DelveCast.com. Mm-hmm. You can find Nathan and I and Delve on the Twitter and on Gmail, DelvePodcast@gmail.com. You can find me at EXP Limited, and you can find our show at Delve Podcast.
And you can find me at Citanium. And so for all of us here at Delve, i.e. the two of us,
the two of us until further notice that someone else has joined our team, and then we'll let you know because we'll do an episode about it.
Oh, yeah. We will let you know if anyone joins us.
That's right.
In the year.
Yeah. If you want to join our team, it's gonna totally do an episode all about you.
It's going to be like on the show.
Yeah.
we want to thank, again, everyone for joining us on the show and this long extended journey that has gone over 200 parts now. And that extends into the next year. The next time you hear me, I am probably going to be experimenting with a unicorn.
That's phrasing. All day long phrasing.
I'm going to be playing around with a character that I wanted to do at some point. I know phrasing.
Still phrasing.
Yeah.
We're going to leave it on the note of phrasing.
There's probably... next time you hear me, it's probably going to be a live play, and there may be a unicorn involved. That's phrasing too, isn't there?
Especially if you go with the Urban Dictionary definition of unicorn.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.